Hey, today's episode is brought to you by Fracture. Fracture is a photo decor company that is out to rescue your favorite images from the digital ether. They print your photos directly onto glass and add a laser-cut rigid backing so they're ready to display right out of the box. They even include the wall anchor. Just upload your digital photo and pick your size. It's that simple. Bring a special memory to life, give it as a unique gift, or decorate your home with the moments that tell your story. For more information and 10% off your first order, visit fractureme.com/podcast. Don't forget to mention Kevin Pollak's Chat Show in their one question survey. It helps support this show. That's fractureme.com/podcast. Grab it by the thing. Oh, hi. Welcome back to Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. I'm not Chat Show. I'm Sam Levine. What a terrible mistake we've all made yet again. The reason I'm sitting here, of course, is because Chat Show himself, Mr. Kevin Pollak, is somewhere in America. He's in Ohio?
No, technically at this very moment, he's on a plane. Oh. But he was like some bizarre town in Ohio that I had never even heard of, being from Western Pennsylvania.
Bizarre town in Ohio.
Yeah, and he's on his way back already. He was only there one nighter. You know, those corporate gigs, you can't turn them down.
You can't say no to those.
Yeah.
You try, but they won't let you.
Exactly.
So you're stuck with me for the next 90 minutes or so, but don't worry, it's going to be fine. You're not even going to notice the difference. Well, you already heard from the wonderful Jamie Foxx. Hello, Jamie Foxx. How are you today?
I'm very well.
Excellent.
Yeah, we some of the crew and I went to a little Oktoberfest festivities last night. It was fun.
That's nice. They have October festivities.
I think it's probably how it should be said. I like the mashup.
They have those here in Los Angeles.
Yeah, we went to the Alpine Village in Torrance.
Ooh, and Torrance.
Yeah, good old Torrance.
Del Amo Mall is there.
I love the Del Amo Fashion Square.
Yeah.
Yes, that's a great mall.
According to the film Jackie Brown, it's the largest indoor mall in the world, but that's probably not true anymore.
It's a very large mall, but it's like half of it's outdoors and half of it's indoor. Nobody wants to know about this.
That film's 19 years old. It's probably not
accurate. But it's a very nice, if you're in the Southern California area, the Del Amo Mall is where it's at.
Okay.
There you go.
I'm definitely gonna be pitching that more to people now that we both have stock in the Del Amo Mall. Just a few important things to cover before we get to our guest. The first and most important thing that I'm sure we're all on the same page with is that the Cubs are crushing it so far in the postseason. Yeah, that's right. You're right to applaud up in the crow's nest. They're 2-0 against Kevin's beloved San Francisco Giants. I'm sorry, Kev. I think it's you know what it is? It's about time. That's what it is. It's about time. It's time for the Cubs to shine. It's only been 107 years since their last championship.
I'm rooting for you guys because for two reasons. One, for BDM.
Yep.
Our former friend. Yeah, all the M's, all the Murrays, but Brian Dole Murray especially. And I want you to get that tattoo.
There's threat of me having to get a tattoo if the Cubs win the World Series. We'll see if it happens. I'm on the fence. It depends on a few circumstances. Mostly how much Jamie pressures me. The second thing I want to talk about is, do you need a writing utensil? You're good.
I'm not supposed to talk, right?
You can talk, you're just not on camera.
Okay, I'm not talk. I thought I would be the guy who doesn't talk until he's introduced.
The second thing I want to tell you about is a show called Crunch Time, which you've heard me mention on this podcast before. It is the streaming series that I act in that is brought to you by roosterteeth.com. It is Sunday, so episode 5 has just posted on roosterteeth.com today. Look, technically the show is behind a paywall, but here's the thing. If you are not a Rooster Teeth subscriber, go to the website and you can get a free 30-day trial subscription to their all of their premium content. And that means you can watch all of Crunch Time, including the first four episodes, the fifth episode, which just posted today, and then the sixth and final episode, which we'll be posting on next Sunday, 1 week from today. It's a really good fucking show. I've been in a lot of terrible things over the last 17 years. Really, really bad things that I don't talk about. I'm talking about this one because it's good, and you should see it, and you're gonna like it, and you should tell people about it. And then you're like, Sam, look, I hate free things. Fine. I don't know what's wrong with you, but you can get them on iTunes. You can pay $3 an episode. You can get a season pass for $10. Watch Crunch Time. You're gonna like it. It's funny. It's sci-fi. It's smart. It's action-y. Fuck it. Just watch it. Thank you. Like, I feel like I'm a good pitch man for that show. I'm not a good pitch man. All right. I feel like we've covered just about everything that I have to cover before getting to our first guest today. Let me preface.
I'm looking at myself in my own. You know, you can switch the camera around. You can look at yourself.
I understand. Let me preface my introduction of today's guest.
I got a circular about that.
By saying this. If you were on the fence about anti-Semitism, if you were wavering, I don't know how I feel about Jewish people.
Yeah.
Tune out. Today's show is not for you. I'm not looking to make any more enemies of the Jewish people. But if you're like, hey, I don't mind Jewish guys and Jewish things and, you know, nebbishy hypochondriac discussions, then boy, are you in for a treat.
You really are anti-Semitic.
A little bit.
Oh, okay.
No.
I see a lot of notes for my introduction.
There are some notes for your introduction.
Is that going to go, are you going to go back to the B list?
I'm going to bring all of the notes.
Comedy on the road?
Today's guest is a friend of the show, friend of the family.
Legend.
Living legend. He is
right,
what is
straight from the Borscht Belt.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. He's what is affectionately known as the comics comic. A man's man, a ladies' man, and a Jewish man.
It's always how they describe failed people with things like comics comic, the poor man's this, the Jewish answer to something else.
The Jewish answer to Jackie Gleason. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Andy Kindler.
Thank you very much. Where do I look? Where do I focus? I would like to focus on you.
I wish you would.
Is this more like a Ken Burns documentary? And then I can go right down the barrel.
That's it.
I don't want to go down the barrel anymore.
Don't go down the barrel.
It's not about me ignoring people and looking into the lens anymore.
No.
I'm going to start getting more callbacks.
You're going to, that's what it's all about.
Yes.
Have you ever done an audition and you do right down the barrel?
I would say 95% of my acting.
Yep.
Is me thinking, am I going to look at the camera now?
Mm-hmm. when are you going to break the fourth wall?
That's all I think
about. It's the countdown to breaking the fourth wall.
Well, I say, I hope I remember my lines while I'm focusing on whether I'll look at the camera or not. I was taught to act like when you get into the part.
Yeah.
And I never could do it that well.
When you mean get into the part, you mean like method acting?
Kind of. The teacher I had upstate New York, I went to, I don't want to.
SUNY Binghamton.
Folks, come on. I'm sorry. That's just the way it shook out.
I knew because, you know.
Yeah, you know.
Famous alum.
So he would do this whole thing where you had to become the character.
Mm-hmm.
And it was always impossible. I was always aware that there was an audience, for example.
Sure.
So 4 years in, one of my friends says to him, because he was intense, and she says, I don't feel like I am the character. And he said, then go with that. And could have saved me 4 years of pain. Then go with that, he says to her.
Go with that.
Meanwhile, with me, he's like, come on, you're not in the moment.
Do you think maybe, he saw her and he went, boy, I don't know why she's wasting her time here. He's never going to get a career. But this Andy guy, there's hope for him. I'm gonna needle him. I'm gonna get him to where he needs to be.
All I can focus on when you say that is the time I went to meet with my director, teacher, and I heard another guy, a friend of mine, talking with him about how horrible an actor I was.
What?
He wasn't wrong.
No. No.
But I was a kid. You know, it wasn't as smooth as people have seen me on the Wizards of Waverly Place, where you think I am a wizard.
Chancellor Tootie Tootie?
Rudy Tootie Tootie.
Rudy Tootie Tootie?
Rudy Tootie Tootie.
Excuse me, that wasn't in the notes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I did have Wizards.
You mean the notes
Waverly.
I sent you?
The notes.
Or the sizzle reel I sent you. Or the vine. Loop. The vine I have loops. Over 2 million vine loops.
What does that mean when people say that?
Do you?
No. But when you go to someone's account, you've never heard of, it's schmala.
I'm trying to increase the anti-Semitism that you started the show with saying.
Yep.
People, if people didn't know why they're not enjoying it,
right?
Now they can remember you did warn them.
I
about
want
Jews.
Them to know, it's not because we're not good entertainers. It's because we're both circumcised.
Well, not only that. I don't know about you, although you insist on showing me your circumcision.
Well, it's a pretty cool scar.
You say, look, if the guy asked for references. My moil wants references. But I noticed before the show that you were also worried. You are what is increasing anti-Semitism because you're afraid of appearing too Jewish. All Jews are. Now, I'm not saying anything that makes any sense. But the
I
point
lean
is...
into the punch.
What's that?
I lean into it. Do you know, I have, I was telling you this when we were before the show, I have to put myself on tape for a role.
Oh, that's right.
Where I have to speak Yiddish.
I've already found out about that role, bumped you.
You bumped me.
And I made my own tape in the woman's room here.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Did you get the part?
Of Iago? I don't know, I can't think of anything to riff of what it was. I forgot what you said it was. It's you speaking Yiddish.
It's me speaking Yiddish, turn of the century Jew.
If I had a dollar, stop typecasting me in all these Yiddish projects.
Hester Street 2, that's a deep cut.
What is that that's from? Is that from Wizards?
No, Hester Street is a 70s movie starring Carol Kane where it's all Yiddish.
Oh,
with subtitles.
You have out-obscured reference to me. Look at this, folks. If you're out there in show business and you need, and you say, hey, we need one of these two types in the business, and the other guy either has to be behind the scenes or excuse himself, I'm passing the baton. I'm passing the baton that does not mean any financial benefit. To Sam, you can have. You are me now.
I'll
congratulations.
Oh, this is the most exciting day.
All the parts.
What were the notes you were taking before?
Oh, Delamo Square used to be my old haunting grounds.
Oh yeah.
Because I used to work as a ghost.
Who's with me? Who
for
gave him
Knott's
the microphone?
Berry Farm. For Knott's Berry Farm. I used to live in the South Bay. And I used to go to and Delamo. Trying to keep me out of that area.
That's weird.
In the 80s.
They tried.
I used to be there in the 80s.
You were there in the 80s.
That's when malls were like the thing. Too.
And hoping to run into the Beach Boys, because the Beach Boys did not grow up far from there.
Really?
They were grew up in Hawthorne.
Oh.
How long was I and the entire nation and all the people who tuned out when they heard I was a Jew out for?
I like that area of Southern California because Jason and I like to call it Anytown USA because it just reminds us of being at home. Like you could be anywhere else in the US because that's where you go for like, you know, your Red Lobsters and your Outbacks.
I don't go anywhere for my Red Lobsters. I order in. I have it on dry. I have Red Lobster ship their terrible lobster on dry ice.
It's terrible.
I want it from another location. I like it from Akron.
Akron.
Not Akron.
Is that how you say it?
I think it's Akron.
It's Akron.
No wonder why I don't ever get booked in Akron.
Well, you've been trying. The way you say it, it sounds like an element.
Well, I still like that Alec Baldwin was very funny with the... he didn't say apologize as Trump.
Oh, from last night?
Apologize.
I haven't seen that.
But it's very funny what he said.
Because
he refused to apologize, so he mispronounced it.
Right.
What? You know what's hilarious?
What's
and
hilarious?
And people love when you recount sketches from shows. It's even worse than when CNN. Hey, did you watch Jimmy Fallon? It's pretty funny. Who talks like that on CNN? I'm doing a 70s
Don
DJ.
Don Lemon talks like that. When he's drunk.
The thing about Don Lemon that's so wonderful is that he's not taken with himself at all. The thing about Don Lemon, no self-importance there.
When is Aaron Brown gonna get his second show?
Oh my God.
I just, in my mind, removed him probably 10 years ago. Oh my God. The kids today don't know. Forget about all the tragedies they think are tragedies. 9/11 was terrible.
Oh God.
But it was not as bad as when we had to watch Aaron Brown night in, and I'm only kidding about 9/11.
Do you know, this is true. So this is your second appearance on the chat show. And the last time you were here was in this same month, October of 2010.
Oh my God.
And I want you to know, I sat there with a stopwatch. It took 17 minutes.
Before, is it Aaron Brown?
No, from when the show started before Kevin introduced you. We used to dawdle a little bit more back in those days.
I do remember it being a while. I remember
17 minutes from
I needed a canteen at one point.
Yes, to you talking. I want you to know I'm aiming to get twice that long before we get to anything
on that list.
Nonsense.
On your questions.
I told you before we started, I wrote a list. I was like, maybe we get to it.
Yeah.
Maybe we get to it.
I bet we get to all of it because no one wants to hear me talk about Aaron Brown. See, Aaron Brown, what did he host on CNN?
I don't know if he was there to, I'm sure they gave him his own nightly show like Wolf Blitzer.
But why was he there? He was always on and he always had an opinion. And it always was his way or the highway.
He started on, what was it, September 9th or 10th, 2001. It was just a
that's what it was.
Yeah.
So he was our conscience. He was our light.
Right.
He was our bugle.
Tuned to CNN.
Yes.
The old guard was out. He was in 48 hours maximum before that happened. Mm-hmm. So then it was 24 hours.
You know how much money he made on that time period?
Probably not a lot.
Not a lot.
He was probably under contract, whether he's on an hour a day or 10 hours a day.
See, that's the thing that's been good about me.
What's that?
If people saw more, and a lot of people say, Andy, is there a podcast you haven't done?
Mm-hmm.
But beyond that, I'm not overexposed because I don't get cast a lot.
Right.
So people, it's not as bad as it could be.
Is that what you have on your headshot?
Well, I think I'm
Andy Kindler, not as bad as it could be.
Well, I have a sense that I could be annoying. It's the difference between me and people who are more annoying, and some people would say, I can't imagine it. But there are, is I know I have an annoying filter.
You do?
Yeah.
And what do you do with
that? Like right now, I know, okay, this is good,
yeah.
But Sam did mention something about 17 minutes in.
Yep.
And so maybe I'll try and focus a little bit.
No.
I have
I don't
no
want
game
your focus.
Plan. I have no game plan.
I don't want your focus. I don't want a game plan. Here's what I want to ask you. So as I mentioned before you could spit it out, and I like pointing at you with this pen. It's very important to me. You went to SUNY Binghamton.
Yep. Yeah. Yes.
Which is a fine school.
This is my new answer voice. Yes.
Yes.
That's true, Sam.
And you majored in English Lit.
I don't like to brag. These are all things I said to you, please bring up. No, I was an English Lit major and I minored in history, but not really. Now that I think about it, and I think I really don't know who won between Aaron Burr and Hamilton, I realize history was a minor. But it was English literature, yes.
What drew you to an English literature major? I'm curious.
All right, well, I always wanted to be a musician, so that was my main thing.
Right.
I told people once, I cannot get this conversation out of my mind. I was like 30 years old, and I was talking to some friends, and I said, yeah, when I was like 20, I was like consumed with just wanting to be Bob Dylan, you know?
Sure.
And it was my dream and everything. And this person said to me, weren't you aware that there already was a Bob? Like, they thought I literally wanted to change into Bob Dylan somehow. That was my life goal. Right. I knew there was a Bob Dylan.
Yeah, and you wanted to kill him, assume his identity.
Or it's the saddest story you've ever heard.
Yeah.
A guy wants to be someone who's pre-existing. So I always wanted to be a musician. But I always liked, for some reason, I liked to write papers, and I liked English literature, and I liked a certain time period a lot. I liked the early 20th century. Like, I liked everything.
Mm-hmm.
I loved everything in the Beat period. I loved, like, the electric Kool-Aid acid test time period.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, I was doing a lot of my own experimentation. But then I went all the way back to, like, Fitzgerald and Hemingway and Sherwood Anderson and all those people. But if I go two more authors in, I'm at my limit.
You're right.
Yeah, because there's things I never really read. I mean, I read a couple of Dickens.
Okay. Yeah, I'm not.
I'm really poorly read. I'm poorly read.
Poorly read for an English literature major.
Well, I've read a lot of, I didn't not read things.
Okay.
I didn't read Cliff Notes.
Right.
You read except when I wrote a paper about the Cliff Notes guy.
His name is Cliff.
How could this joke not go over?
I don't understand. Full audience.
Cliff Notes jokes?
No. One of them.
What's next? My Trapper Keeper chunk? So, and I loved it. So I did love it. And also, I learned how to write papers very well. It sounds stupid now, but at the time, I was so impressed with myself. No, I knew how to introduce what I was going to say.
That's great. And so were you a good student?
I was a good student in the sense that because I was an English literature major, but if I had good grades, but I wasn't like a guy who was a genius. And on that level, as a person, let's not kid ourselves.
No.
I can think of only two, three people at my level of looks, genius, and a third fake thing.
Yep.
But I was a good student, but you know what I'm talking about. You probably, I see you as who I wanted to be.
Mm-mm.
You were valedictorian.
Not even close.
You got 800 on your SATs.
Nope.
I mean, each part of it.
Nope, none of that. I was wildly disinterested in school.
Yeah, but if you had applied yourself,
maybe.
And we'll be back with two guys talking about how the other one's a genius. Well, actually, you didn't say I was a genius. I filled that in.
Yes, you did.
But I did love.
Unspoken, though.
I did love. I loved school too.
You
I
did.
Had the greatest time. I graduated. I went to school in the '70s.
Oh.
We had LSD. You had your mushrooms. You had your pot. You
they
had
called
whip,
it grass
whippets.
Back then.
We didn't call it grass.
You didn't? Not in upstate New York.
No. Hmm. In fact, I almost got arrested once.
Tell me that.
On my friend and I were hitchhiking. Ended up hitchhiking to a Grateful Dead concert.
Where was the concert?
It was in Englishtown, New Jersey.
You got to get from Binghamton to Englishtown.
And the guy who drove us there, everybody was high back then. You just were. I don't even know what you were high on. But he says, "Oh, I got to drop you guys off."
Ooh.
This guy says.
Yeah.
Me and my hippie-looking friend. He drops us off on the New Jersey Turnpike.
Uh-oh.
It was like the worst drug laws in the country.
Yeah.
You could go to jail.
Sure.
Within 2 minutes, we were stopped by New Jersey policemen.
Well, you were just standing on the side of the turnpike.
Hitchhiking.
Yeah.
Hippie hitchhikers.
So you went with a friend who knew you from Binghamton, who then was like, get out of the car.
He right threw here me turnpike. And my other friend out.
He threw you out for no good reason, or were you...
Or we were too... We probably were told. Maybe he said, don't forget, guys, as soon as I hit New Jersey.
Right.
But we didn't remember.
You don't remember because of all the weed.
We weren't whippets.
No.
Whippets.
Whippets.
You ever take a whippet?
No.
Do you know what a whippet is?
I do.
It's unbelievable for 12 seconds.
Really?
Don't kid yourself. It's like getting high at the dentist
all right.
for 14 seconds.
Kenny, go get some Ready Whip.
It's not that easy. That's the problem with
I feel like it is that easy.
With you kids today. So he drops us off, and then the cop, and so we have everything. I had about 8 stories in college where I had everything.
Yeah.
I had acid. I had pot. I was holding someone's... Quaaludes. I'll be back. Because I used to make a joke about how when I would go to Grateful Dead concerts, which I did, you know, someone would come up to me and go, take 3, they're weak.
Uh-oh.
We didn't even know what they were.
Right.
All we knew was that 2 wasn't enough.
2 wasn't enough.
Yeah. So that's
4 and 4 will kill you.
4 will kill you. And it is amazing when you think of, like, the guy who was in The Pretenders, James Honeyman Scott, and all these people. I think there's so many musicians died... Not because they were drug addicts, they just took the wrong thing at a party. And we'll be right back with the most depressing stories of all time.
Anyway, throwing a commercial. We're not
okay. So the guy gets out. So the cop, pulls us over, and he starts looking through my friend's backpack. And my friend had pot in a vial, a film vial.
Uh-oh.
You know those film
canisters? Yeah.
The canisters.
Yeah.
They were only used for pot mostly.
And film occasionally.
Occasionally, the policeman. Takes the vial, lifts it up, looks around, and puts it back in as if it's a film vial. So I'm thinking, how were they taught back? What did they call it?
Yeah.
If I wasn't calling it grass, what'd they call it? Chiba?
Chiba?
They weren't taught. If you see a film vial, you're Eureka?
No, those Binghamton kids, they're too sly for the...
I mean, you told me you take
Cubs.
Your pot in a hollowed out... Right guard can.
That's
an aerosol right guard
aerosol
can.
Right guard can.
From the 50s.
It's true. Me and Wayne Knight, we smuggle it back from.
His was
Jurassic
Barbasol.
Park. I know.
I feel like.
I know, but I thought.
But
my mind went there too.
I feel like we're doing a Robert Klein panel album. You know what? I just realized that I launched into that story as if I was on The Moth. And you know what? You know what I say when I watch The Moth? I used to love The Moth. I used to love everything until it got ruined. Well, I used to love stories on The Moth, but now, 5 minutes into it, I say, why don't you and your story get a room?
That's what you say?
None of my NPR jokes work. How about where they have these game shows on the weekends?
Yeah.
Hoo, 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 ha, 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 mm-hmm. Don't tell me.
Wait.
I know.
Wait, wait, don't tell
wait
me.
Wait a second. Hold it, buddy boy.
Yeah.
Give me a chance.
These are
where
all...
people are only slightly amusing because it's Saturday morning and they haven't had their coffee yet.
Right.
Slow risers.
Slow risers.
Which was Paul Reiser's worst show.
My mind went there too.
That was his worst show.
Taking notes.
Slow risers.
Andy is literally writing slow risers down on his index card. If you were one of the lucky few to see him at Bananas
Go
next
Bananas.
Weekend, at Go Bananas, and, you are going to hear his slow risers chunk.
And bring it around. And Paul Reiser, where did he go to school, Sam Levine?
GoBananas.com.
No, he went to Binghamton.
Binghamton, that's right. You same class, right?
I told Paul Reiser that. I met, this is a great story. Remember how the other story was terrible? Wait till you hear this
one. Oh, boy.
Paul Reiser, I see him at some party. Probably at Phil... I don't know who I'm hiding it from. Phil Rosenthal's house.
Creator of Everybody Loves Raymond.
Yes. So I say to Paul Reiser, we went to the same school. And he says, okay, then. That was it. That was his reaction.
He didn't go there, too?
I went to school with him. Why isn't he like... Did you go to the union? Did you ever see the ba-ba-ba? Did you know Schmicky the boom-boom? And none of it.
None of it?
None of it. Didn't care.
Not interested.
Couldn't care less.
Doesn't it bother you when people say could care less when they mean couldn't?
Well, I only... Because you're a stickler. You're like an Edwin Newman type.
That's how I've always thought of myself.
And I've always... See, I want to go for references that make the ambient sound less.
You want the crickets to have crickets.
Yeah, I want it to be like, oh my God, it's even more depressing than it was when nothing was going on.
Right. I want people, when they're watching or listening to this show, to have their finger on the pause button at all times so that they can Google these references.
I want
to enjoy it.
Right, but I also want to use fast forward and rewind a lot.
Yeah? Jump
because
around?
I think 3 years from now, fast forward or rewind, people will think you're like had a horse and buggy.
So what are they going to do in 3 years from now?
Don't cross-examine me, professor, or attorney.
It seemed like you had your finger on the pulse of what the alternative was going to be.
No.
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 It's just...
I'm an idea guy. I bring it up.
That's what I've always said.
My friends,
you.
I love when George Foreman says, my friend, because he can't say that he had the Foreman grill.
Right.
He can't say it for some kind of contractual reason. Well, because he's doing indent help.
Right.
But so he can only say, my friend is saying to me, George, what do I do about my invention? And for the first 4 years I heard the commercial, I was like, why are they going up to George Foreman and asking what to do with their inventions? You know, then I remembered his grill.
According to Hulk Hogan, this is true.
Don't get me started.
Mr. Saturday Night. Are you in that? Why aren't you in
that? I am in that. That was based on me.
It
was based on me.
If you're not in that movie, it's a crime.
If I am that movie. If that movie didn't exist, I would be that guy.
Oh,
movie.
Oh, boy. Hulk Hogan.
If I have to invent it.
Claims they offered him what's ultimately known as the Foreman Grill first.
Oh my
God. To be the pitch man, but he was out. He didn't get the message. He didn't call back within like 2 hours, and then they moved on and offered it to Foreman, who was home.
First of all, I'm glad that God intervened.
Yeah.
Because nobody wants to be thinking of Hulk Hogan when they're grilling for the rest of their life.
That does sound familiar, though. I think I've heard that.
That's
yeah,
true,
but
yeah.
You want to think about Hulk Hogan? Who's the one who said something racist?
All of them.
Yeah.
All of them?
You don't have to worry about that with George Foreman. You don't have to worry. I wonder if the guy made this grill hates African-Americans. No. You know why?
Why?
He wouldn't name it after himself, and he probably doesn't hate himself. This is like the world's worst bit that could veer if under less able hands could be something that would veer into the most depressing territory.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to put my pen mic down.
Thank you. Somebody unplug his microphone.
Someone unplug whatever it is that my energy level.
What is this that you drank?
This is a search engine. Yeah, this has its own
soft drink line, apparently.
Bing it on. Hey, I get $50 every time I say Yahoo it. I just signed a deal with Yahoo. Do I know a lot? Oh, you're a minor in history. Do I know a lot about a certain event?
You have a minor in history.
That's true.
Do you know a lot about the Hindenburg disaster?
No, but when I don't know, I Yahoo it. $50, boom. But where you should, this is actually part of my act though, where you shouldn't go, this is true.
Yeah.
Do not go to ask.com.
Do not.
No.
Why not?
Because you go there, yeah, and I swear to God, it says, yeah, we were wondering exactly too. Yeah, thanks for joining the conversation. Here's the top three answers of other people who came here not knowing what the answer was, what their guess is.
Wow. So basically ask.com, if you ask a question, it goes, try Google.
Or they direct you over the redirected to your guess is as good as ours .gov.
It's a government.
Oh, we got where political. Are,
Sam. Oh, I'm sorry. I forgot where I was.
Hey, so you went to summer camp as a kid.
This is true.
I went to a
YMCA. I'm a Jew.
Yeah.
There's no getting around it. Although, believe me, if I had to try and get around it, I would.
Let's pretend for
I'm not a Jew. I'm not a Jew.
Let's pretend for a second, for a split second, you and I are wandering around Poland, 1938-39.
Is this before or after the guy asked you if you had your horns?
I'm so glad you remember that story.
How could you forget that story?
It's a crazy story,
right? How many times in your life does someone go...
He didn't ask me. He asked the other camper I was with. How quick... Do we make it 10 minutes?
What's that?
Trying to masquerade as non-Jews.
Oh, us, we're dead. Us.
It's over, right?
We're dead. There's not even a thought. You know how you could do a thought experiment?
Yeah.
We're dead.
We're dead.
Within 10 minutes.
Right.
What? How are you going to deny being a Jew?
I can't.
Or at least...
A few people have asked me over the years if I might be Italian, but then I speak, and it's all over.
Yeah. Well, neither one of them. Are you a man of 18,000 voices, too?
Six.
Let me hear your Italian guy. Or your Boston guy. I love what Boston.
I don't do a good Boston. I don't do a good Boston. But if
you can see Ted too, best goddamn animated movie I ever saw. Forget the original. And also, do you like westerns?
I do.
Wild West is the best movie I ever saw of the bar none. Better than High Noon.
What?
It's like High Noon, but funnier.
Did you like giant mechanical spiders?
Was that in Wild West?
Yeah, that's how the movie ends. Kenneth Branagh rides a giant mechanical.
Oh, no spoiler alert.
I'm saving you the trouble.
That movie ended? Boom, ba-bang, chi-ping, wing.
I don't do like a good Italian. What I do is probably Jon Stewart doing Italian.
Whoa!
You saved it.
Yeah, that was the most coordinated move a Jew has ever made in the history of the world.
And we caught it on camera.
Including Sean Green when he hit a three-run shmaboopy.
But you're a Mets fan.
I am a Mets fan, but for some reason, Lou Schneider, who you know.
Sure.
From Chicago. You know Lou Schneider?
Yeah. Not personally.
I saw the Met game with him. He was at my bachelor party.
Okay.
And every time Sean Green would get up to play, he would go, yeah, ba ba da 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 yay, 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 hey, because there's only four Jewish athletes
in the history.
Total, including Jim Thorpe.
I don't think he was.
I interrupted you.
No, I'm glad you stopped me. I'm not going to do my horrible Italian.
Oh no, do your horrible Italian, please.
Well, I tell you what I prefer to do is Hank Azaria's old Italian stereotype from The Simpsons. What is it, Don?
Oh, not Luigi?
No, not Luigi.
There is still the matter of your debt.
I like
$48.
Here's a 50.
And to your change, and we thank you.
Wow. That sounds like, it sounds almost Boris Karloff. It sounds like you're not going to get a lot of work in whatever area that would be.
No, definitely not.
What is it? What are we on, the bus route?
We are on the bus route. That is a huge truck.
Do I switch here for the E? No, that's a subway joke.
Yeah, no, it's not going to work.
That's all that is. That's not far off though, because down now that the metro line opened up down here, that's all. It's all public transportation and very pedestrian friendly. Very difficult to drive a vehicle.
Very pedestrian. That was the name of my first CD. Very pedestrian. I thought it was jokes about walkers. People saw it as a statement on the material. Who likes sandwiches? Remember that bit?
Sure.
What? Let me get this straight. You put the meat in between some kind of a bread item. That's the New York comic who's got nothing. Hey, let me get this straight. Sandwich. Let me get this straight. You take a chicken, you stick it between some ciabatta.
It's Don Vittorio. Thank you, J-Man.
Don Vittorio.
Don Vittorio. It is all Italian stereotype. No, Don, you know, no, I am.
Can you do the guy on the pizza carton who goes like that? He's like, mwah. That guy. He's got an Italian hat of some type. And he still seems delighted by his ability. His perennial emotion is mwah. Let me see how we're doing on time.
We're doing great. No, we're doing
great.
We're doing great on time.
Not bad.
You about the YMCA.
Yeah, I went to YMCA summer camp.
Yes.
It's actually a little bit depressing.
Oh, good.
I hope my mom's not listening.
Probably.
She hasn't listened in 12 years. When I was 7, I was born in October, and I know you have a big thing about this.
Not a big thing,
but just a way of both sinking my career age-wise and mocking me. No, but I was born in October, so I was born late in the year. So, like, I was 7 and almost not even 8 years old.
Oh,
I went to summer camp.
In your class.
Yeah, I went to summer camp for a month. I was 8 years old. I went to summer camp for 2 months.
Right.
And it was, at the time, it was very traumatic, but it was actually, because Jews did that at some point.
Sure.
I don't know if they still do.
But not to the YMCA.
That was a thing that was popular, probably just in my family.
Yeah.
There were other people too, but it was, they were camps that were also in this part of New York that was kind of nice.
Okay.
But
now
they
were
rustic.
You're from Queens, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And Whitestone. So where was the camp?
Port Jervis, New York. Huguenot, New York.
I'm familiar with Port Jervis and their medical center.
And three camps near each other, McAllister, Talcott, and Greenkill. So I went there from age 8 to like age 14, 2 months out of every summer.
And it was an overnight camp, sleepaway camp.
Yeah, horrible latrines, that kind of thing.
Wow.
Back in those days.
Yeah.
That's all I think about until I was 18. All I thought about were those latrines and having to use them, and when I would go to camp, all I would think about all day long was avoiding the latrine. But that's only one way of looking at it. The other way of looking at it was really fun.
Yeah,
I had like campfires. Right. I went on hikes, and I went and camping. Have you gone camping?
Sure.
Because I don't see it. Your soft baby's bottom skin that you have on your hands.
Yeah.
Does not. I don't see you as having erected a tent.
Glad you said tent.
Yeah, or any kind of erection.
None.
Not since the treatments, but camping is always bad. Camping?
I couldn't agree with you more.
It's always
camping
terrible.
Camping is a lose-lose proposition.
It's a terrible idea.
Even if it's wildly successful, it's still miserable.
And the reason why you don't go camping is that we purposely evolved just to get away from camping.
Just to get away. We're taking a giant step back.
We don't need it.
No.
This is from my hilarious camping bit. From my before very pedestrian, I had an EP.
It was an EP. With Alan Sherman, yeah?
Yes, it was like...
It was a double album?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Forget what he's talking about. If you liked Hello Mudda, Hello Fada, but you wanted the same without the delightful music... But more like boring anecdotes.
More complainy. Boom. If you're
more
looking
complaint.
For just general complaints about sleepaway camp.
Andy Killen. And the worst part, you know what the worst part was?
What's that?
Swimming.
Ugh.
I'm a terrible swimmer.
Yeah.
I can now. I can float on my back. That's my only hope.
That's a good skill.
I could do that maybe for a couple hours before
the drowning.
And I'm taking someone down with me, like if it's me and you.
Right.
Yes.
My last tactic will be to use you as a flotation.
I couldn't agree with you more. Here's the thing, I sink like a stone.
I'm the same way.
I won't understand that.
No.
I'll try and stand on your submerged body.
Yes.
So we used to have to go swimming at 8 in the morning at the lake.
Too early. It's freezing.
The lake.
Freezing.
And I hated it. And I never, and every year I would start it and from a minnow, which was like you couldn't, and I would end up as a fish. This minnow, fish, flying fish, shark, whale, porpoise.
The porpoise?
Yeah.
That was the last one?
Just to add insult to injury. I'm porpoise.
Yeah.
I'm fish. Not even a flying fish. Minnow, fish, flying fish, shark, and the other two things I mentioned earlier.
You beat me to the Abe Vigoda joke when you said you were fish. I couldn't get there.
He finally did die.
He did.
That's Abe the Vigoda. World's worst trivia player.
Isn't it?
Now he finally did die.
He's really dead this time, though,
yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Hal Linden, still alive.
Only you and four other people would use that version of the joke. Hal Linden, on the other hand, no problems.
Well,
he sits and watches Brooklyn Nine-Nine and throws a can at the TV.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why I'm saying that. I know you love Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
Are you on that show?
Well, I'm not on that show. I just want to say, when I think of believable detectives,
yep,
think of Andy Samberg.
It's a comedy. Just keep that in mind. It's a comedy.
That's what the writers say. Keep it in mind. I don't know what I'm saying. But,
that's,
you know,
right. I'm not going to... That ship is... It's not like, oh, God, I wonder if Andy's going to... not get invited on that show.
Right.
Yes, Andy will not be invited on that show.
And we can circle around to that, because first I do want to talk about something legitimate.
Okay.
That is a real part of your career, that is a show I know you were on, because I watched every episode of this show, Marin.
You're going to make me cry
on IFC.
Now. Oh, wow.
I watched every episode of Marin on IFC.
What?
It was a very enjoyable show. You were
I
very
loved
enjoyable
doing it.
On it. And I would like to know a little bit about your experience. I know you and Marin go way, way back.
Marin and I go so far back. Well, I think everybody can tell from this show and everything else I've done that I tend to build up things like something's coming.
Yeah.
So, and I'm guilty of hyperbole. So I was going to go into that. Me and Marin go so far back, we were in nursery school together, or make up something. But we do go very far back in that I knew him from the late 80s.
That's pretty far.
And then we both I'm always at a career low point, but he, so to me, it was like, I understand this feeling. 2008, the crash.
Yep.
Joy. Welcome to my world. Now we're playing on my terms. But I remember when we did a tour when we both, like, nothing was going on for either of us, and nothing was going, and he was, like, getting divorced or whatever. He had a lot of, everything was not going his way, and when he early did the podcast, I remember we were doing it at the hotel, I think, in Montreal.
Sure.
And it was like, I'm not saying we were depressed while we were doing it,
right.
But it wasn't like we were doing it going, this is the podcast that Obama's going to be on.
Well, it would have been weird if he'd had the forethought then.
Yeah.
When he was like, I think this is going to be so popular, I'm going to get the president, a sitting president, to come on this podcast.
Right, which I still, not only did I love that it happened, I also listened to all the shows where he talked about the preparation for it.
Oh, yeah.
Because his partner, I forgot.
I know.
I loved that episode where he talked about that, too. So, I don't know. So, anyway, I got very close with Mark from, we did a tour together.
Yep.
We fought a lot on that tour. It was me, Eugene Merman, and Mark. And we fought a lot.
The three of you, or just you and Mark?
No, Eugene.
Yeah, he's a pretty, affable guy.
Yeah, Eugene's whole thing is, you two are ridiculous.
Yep.
And but I'm very calm.
Yeah.
Where's the gales of laughter from people who know all three of us? So,
thank you.
So when Marin came, I really don't know how I got on that show, but all of a sudden I'm on that show.
Come on.
Well, I'm telling you, I didn't get on that show from going on an audition for Andy.
I would hope not. That would be strange.
Because I wouldn't have gotten the part.
Can you imagine if they sent you an audition for, like, okay, it's the role of Andy Kindler playing himself on Marin, and then they hire someone else. They hire me.
Yeah.
To play Andy Kindler
This happens all the time. They just don't tell me it. The part never comes out as Andy Kindler.
Right.
But it's someone at one point during process goes, you know that Andy Kindler guy? He does that speech in Montreal. Shouldn't we? Maybe not. We shouldn't.
No.
Goes right past it.
Goes right past
and
it.
I never knew it happened.
Right.
So this was like a dream come true, was being on this show.
Yeah.
Because I love Marin because my thing is I like comedies where it's like Seinfeld, I believed Seinfeld.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas even though Curb could be hilarious, I never believed Curb.
Right.
So I kind of gravitate more towards sitcoms that are really because I grew up on Woody Allen stuff where it comes out of the character. And I think when you watch the early show, Years of Kindler, my acclaimed sitcom about my life, you saw on that show how my philosophy of what I like, I was able to translate on my own terms.
Yes, you were.
This is a joke about how I haven't done anything on my own.
That's not...
I'm the go-to, I'm Hollywood's go-to guy.
You are Hollywood's go-to guy.
Who am I? What is the character I'm doing today?
I have no idea.
You think
it's not just today, Andy. Let's not limit it to just here.
Is this part
table.
Of it? Because I'd like to add this kind of stuff to my acting, more like this. What are these called? Idiosyncrasies?
No.
Did I answer your questions either about Marin, Jews, or what was it like to be on Marin?
I don't know that I specifically asked any of those questions. I just wanted
to... I like to pretend that there is a studio audience.
There is.
This, and then even to the point of me saying, this guy knows what I'm talking about over here.
Yeah.
Just like, is it Elijah?
Elijah the prophet comes and visits during Passover. That's
right.
Correct. Yeah.
There should be a similar seat, and it should be non-denominational. There should be a similar tradition with comedy clubs. Mm-hmm. I have had that tradition my whole career. There were always a series of empty seats for a series of prophets. There's Elijah, Bernie.
Bernie the prophet. Phil.
Phil. Uncle Seymour.
Yep.
And three other Jewish names in ascending comedic order.
Yep. I'm going to say Marvin.
Funny.
Seth. Not as funny.
Not as good.
And Shlomo.
Shlomo is Money in the Bank. Which was the name of his bank.
Shlomo is Money in the Bank.
I'm Shlomo. Come on down. You want your money in the bank? This is why there isn't an Andy Kindler show, because that's what I would pitch.
Mm.
I play Shlomo.
Yep.
He owns his bank, which he calls Money in the Bank.
I want you to do me a favor.
He's a banker, but he says he's crazy.
Take the other side of
I'm crazy at Shlomo's.
Take the other side of that index card. Start writing your first draft of Shlomo. In his bank, while I pay the coffers, and I have to read a lad here, so.
I don't think it's known as paying the coffers.
It is not. It is definitely not known as paying the coffers. Hey! Fracture!
Can you take that again, but even more inauthentic?
There's no way.
Maybe you can do it as an animatronic robot.
Transition seamless. I'm going to do this as one of the malfunctioning robots from Westworld. Topical! Fracture is a photo decor company that is out to rescue your favorite images from the digital ether. I know it sounds like you heard me say that at the top of the show, but I really want to make you understand. What they're doing is they take your photos. It's not some photo you found on the internet. They take your photos, you send them in, and then they put them onto glass with a laser cut backing. It's really cool. It's impossible to describe. I really want you to go to their website and check it out because they actually look really, really cool. So they do this laser cut backing, and then they're ready to display right when they get sent to you. Like, you don't have to go out and get a hanger. You don't have to buy a horrible cord or whatever. It's ready to go. You can put it up on the wall, and they include the wall anchor for it. So go to their website. You upload your photo. You pick the size. And the fracture process, they make the color and contrast of your photos really pop. And the sleek frameless design lets your photos stand out while it still matches any decorating style. You can bring a special memory to life, give it as a unique gift, decorate your home with the moments that tell your story. Fractures come with a 60-day happiness guarantee, so you're gonna love your order. So you take it, you put it in your home, you let it sit there 40, 50 days, you're like, I don't know, that was a bad memory. Fracture's gonna give you your money back. Boom, it's got a happiness guarantee. Each Fracture is handmade in Gainesville, Florida from US source materials in their carbon neutral factory. But check this out. For more information and 10% off your first order, go to fractureme.com/podcast. Mention Kevin Pollak's Chat Show in their one question survey. It helps support this very show. That's fractureme.com/podcast. And thank you to Fracture for sponsoring the show. Thank you very much. Andy.
I just, unbelievable. I was tweeting. Mm-hmm. I was tweeting. You doing that and talking about it in real time.
In real time?
This is what's great about live...
Live internet?
Streaming. Streaming. Yep. This is the future, what we're doing
this
here.
This is the future.
Yeah. People need to listen. This is like a sporting event.
Yeah?
If you missed it now...
Don't bother.
You're not going to want to later on.
No. Definitely don't download this show after the fact. So we have a segment on this show. We have a caller called Tweet 5. Any chance that's ready to go?
Oh, my God.
Up there?
Oh, I would love to see you.
You can answer me.
I would love to see you start yelling at your staff.
I don't know what happened. I turned and I asked a question, and then I was met with silence.
I am outraged.
Thank you.
I am outraged by the incompetence of everybody but Sam Levine.
No. It's not incompetence.
These people stink.
It's insubordination.
Insubordination.
Because I am not.
Who's in charge?
Kevin is in charge.
Charles is in charge. Was that Scott Baio's show?
It was Scott Baio's show.
Yeah, that guy really made some very good moves.
He's made some
Kevin says that all decisions. The time as well. He's always amazed about it. He's like, you know how much Scott Baio's worth? It's ridiculous. Yeah. Chachi.
I am so disappointed.
His name is Charles. He's Charles to us. He's Chachi to...
If Scott Baio goes sour, what's the point in continuing?
If he can't earn $1.5 million a year, there's something wrong with the world. That's what I say.
Absolutely.
So we have a little game on the show called Tweet 5. Roll that intro.
Tweet 5. People aren't ready. The intro's not ready. It's just 2 seconds.
They're running it. I assure you they're running it.
Well, how come I can't hear it?
We're good. They're running it right now.
Where's my headphones?
We don't have any monitors.
Where are my cans?
We don't have monitors. We're downgraded. This is not a professional
studio. Where are my cans? And when I say cans, I mean breasts.
Of course you do.
That's my new bit. I say, where are my breasts?
When you mean cans.
I don't know. But I'm very, all of a sudden... I got sick as if this could be a career ender for me.
I can assure you.
Like a Michael Richards. I shouldn't say that. That's not a career ender.
That wasn't.
Kind of.
Because it was already.
No, it was just not as bad.
What's
he shouldn't be continuing to send it out as a vine.
That's the mistake. So a T5 is a rapid fire, this or that.
Okay.
This or that, Coke or Pepsi. No wrong answers.
Look at this. This is my go-to. Mode. And this is, if you want to cast me and a guy sitting at a desk who considers things like this.
Mm-hmm. Pensive Kindler. Here we go. All right, Pensive Kindler. This is your Tweet 5 coming to you from at Eli Van Scythe. I think I'm pronouncing that correctly. Scythe?
Oh my God, you sound like the world's oldest Jew.
Here we go.
Negotiating a thing.
Here we go. From the old Jew to the slightly older Jew. Challah or rye?
Challah.
That's incorrect. Gervais or Leno?
I guess Gervais.
Okay. Kevin's hats or Marin's plaid shirts?
Marin's plaid shirts.
That's also correct. Dr. Katz or Dr. Quinn?
Dr. Katz.
That's correct. And depression or anger?
Anger.
Ooh, why?
I'm good at it.
Yes, you are.
Wheelhouse.
That's your calling card.
That's my self-sabotaging ticket to Palookaville.
Hello. Now, you brought this up before. I have it, of course, here in my notes. There's been a staple of the Montreal Just for Laughs Festival.
You say it was like years. Almost as if, when is it going to be considered irrelevant? I know the subtext to what you're saying.
There was no subtext.
I have to create you a bête noir. Which I didn't know what it was until Harry Shearer told me.
Okay.
Do you know what that is? Mm. Of course you do.
Mm. I mean, out of the context you just gave me, I could probably
figure
it
mean,
out.
Does it literally mean black bug? What does bête noir mean, everybody? It's your enemy.
Okay. Jamie's got a computer. Nah, she's not going to look it up.
Noir means black.
That I know.
Noir. My favorite character, and I know you're upset about this too.
Uh-oh.
I haven't been the same since Garrison Keillor left.
Oh.
And... how do I know that scan works on my radio anymore on Saturday when I'm driving?
Ooh, topical.
He did that. Yep. He did Guy Noir. He would do a sketch about noir.
Yep.
Because it's so popular, you need to parody it. I'm sorry. Are you friends with Garrison Keillor or
Garrison
something?
Keillor and I have a standing Sunday brunch that I have canceled.
With Chuck McCann?
That I have canceled every Sunday for 7.5 years so I could be here instead.
That, you know how special that doesn't make me feel?
I want to talk about the Andy Kindler
Please
State
do.
Of the Industry Address.
Yes, every year at Montreal.
Every year at Montreal, just for laughs. For 20 fucking years, you've been doing this since the 90s.
I just did it the 20th year of
That's
it.
That's crazy. Congratulations,
It is crazy.
By
Thank you very much. Thank you.
You're very welcome. Now, you talked about this a little bit the last time you were here, so there's going to be some slight overlap, but just to catch people up to speed who maybe didn't hear your first appearance.
Or live 6 years ago.
Or who were not alive 6 years ago. A lot of our fans are 4 to 5 years old. We're very big. Parents put on the show, and they leave us to nanny the children.
This is the new demographic I'm going for.
Yeah.
Six-year-olds and 90 to 100.
90 to 100.
Yeah.
Nothing in between them.
Yeah.
So how did it come about that you wound up doing the show in the first place?
Well, first I did. I went to the
Just for Last
Festival in like 1993,
mm-hmm.
and I didn't go back in 94, and then every year from that time I went back. And in 95, I did a Hack Comics demonstration because I had written for National Lampoon the uh-huh. Hack Comics Handbook,
right.
which is on my website right. under And Then Some maybe, or None of the Above or something like that. And that was like identifying the tropes, if that's a word.
Yep, that is the word.
And making fun of what was terrible in comedy, which sure. in those days were, what part of the chicken does the Jack Nicholson impression come from? and then I did a demonstration of Hack Comedy sure. up in Montreal, and that was really fun. Patton Oswalt mm-hmm. and a million people mm-hmm. playing Apache. And then the next year they said, why don't you do something else? And my manager, Bruce Smith, just happened to come up with State of the Industry.
Love it.
And I started to do it, and the first year was like amazing, like one of those amazing things. And the first couple of years were amazing, but then there were down years. But then for some reason, it just kept going and going and going.
It's very popular.
And sometimes it was terrible to do it. We moved hotels.
Right.
And it's a kind of a review of what's bad in comedy.
Yep.
And it's just turned into a thing that I would like to be buried.
It's kind of.
I'd like to be buried during it.
If I may, it's kind of you're roasting. The state of comedy, but there's no dais, and it's just you, and
there's a lectern.
There is a lectern.
So it's kind of like a podium. You're right, though, and exactly what you say about mm-hmm. it is the secret to when I have to remember when it's better. Yeah. I used to love when Letterman would do like a mean joke, and if it didn't get a laugh, you go, oh, I'm sorry, I thought this was a roast. So the years right. that are actually, when I look back, that are the most, not that I should judge it, because sometimes I am talking about serious things. Like one year I was talking about Opie and Anthony, and Anthony
mm-hmm.
had gone on this like rant. It's yeah. a whole long story, but yeah. I was reading his rants.
Sure.
And I was wondering why they weren't getting a good reaction, mm-hmm. but they were not funny. So like some years I got into topics that were like controversial, but then controversial and made people feel bad, which what I was trying to do.
Mm-hmm.
But then sometimes when it's roast-like, that's my favorite thing. Like comparing comedians to Hitler would be
sure.
like the roast-like part of it.
Sure. Who? What was? Who was your big
the first
topic?
Oh, this year.
This year.
Well, one thing I did that was I talked about before. I did say that I was talking about how Louis C.K.
Mm-hmm.
I always rant about Louis C.K. I love. To look, I'm envious of him. Mm-hmm. I mean, in real life, I'm mm-hmm. envious of him. I'm jealous of him. Not like so bad that it affects the way I live.
Right.
And I'm smart enough to not fall into the, well, can I have what he has? But there is that part of like, what's he, how come he's, you know, on a base level, there's that.
Sure.
But then I also kind of knew him. And I kind of still know him.
Mm-hmm.
And so I talk about him almost every year since I started talking about him.
Yeah.
And I do kind of pretend that I'm angrier, but I'm not really pretending.
Right.
But this one, what I talked about was that about 8 months ago, he emailed his fans, and the media went crazy because he compared Donald Trump to Hitler. Huh? And because he's so successful,
And that's my whole thing. It's like the media loves him because he's successful. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't even matter if he's funny anymore. In fact, on his show, Louis, as soon as he found out that people liked the comedy, he said, I'm going the other way now. You like the comedy? No more jokes. And people are like, that's why he's a genius. Most people would put more jokes there. He went the other way. No jokes.
No jokes.
Because he keeps you guessing.
Yeah.
What's going to be funny next? And I also said that his fashion sense is American Gervais. But then the other thing I said was that he compared Donald Trump to Hitler. I said, and people went crazy like it was a genius thing. And I've been comparing people to Hitler since I was 6 years old. And so then I went through a whole series of how I first compared Dan Cook to Hitler. Mm-hmm. But Dan Cook's worse because at least Hitler had a point of view. Bill Maher was like Hitler, except Hitler's likable. Trump is like Hitler, except at least Hitler is a veteran. Trump is like Hitler, except at least Hitler had a plan. And then the other thing was that Louis C.K. asked his fans not to vote for Trump.
Right.
So I said, I'm really concerned that the people who would download Horace and Pete, I hope they don't make the fateful decision to vote for Trump. And now I notice that most people don't know what Horace and Pete is.
I feel like within the industry, mm-hmm. people know, but maybe in
which industry?
The cottage industry. I feel like maybe it might not be as well known in the heartland.
I think it's a classic example of when something doesn't work for me, I assume it's the reference. Oh, they must not know Horace and Pete. No, right. Maybe it's weak, what you're saying. No, but my whole thing is like people downloading Horace and Pete are not voting for
they're
Donald
not, I don't think they're voting, period.
Yeah.
They're not voters.
Oh, I didn't think of that.
Yeah. Did you watch Horace and Pete?
No, because I did stop at the paywall.
Ah, I understand.
I was dissuaded. I kind of want to watch it, and I'm not against paying $30 or whatever it costs.
Just for the whole thing.
But I know it's going to be serious. Did you watch it?
I watched most of it.
And so what's your review?
It was very different for you know what I expected, but it's pretty well written and acted. Certainly.
Everything he does is good.
Yeah. Yeah. Why hasn't he hired us? Do you think maybe...
He's never going to hire me. He shouldn't hire me.
No?
Because I think that I have problems with him, and why would he want to work with someone who has problems with him?
Well, Dane Cook was on Louis. You remember that?
Dane Cook I'd work with.
Yeah, but... Do you remember Dane Cook?
Yeah, I do remember that.
See, that was quite something.
Well, that's the interesting thing about we're talking about the kind of comedies I like. Like, to me, I'm going to finally button up a previous thought.
Please.
Seinfeld.
Yep.
The part of Seinfeld that I thought was the funniest part, and they had an article about it in the New Yorker about it years ago, was that Jerry and Larry David, they walk around New York and they go into Korean delis and they would like spritz with each other.
Yeah.
And they go, who buys unwrapped candy or something? Yeah. And then the light bulb went off, this could be a show.
Yeah.
That's the funniest part of Seinfeld to me. And I'm not bothered by the intersection of the plots.
Mm-hmm.
It worked on that show for the most part.
Sure. Very well written.
It didn't seem contrived. In some of the episodes it was, because you're it's always four plots.
Not always, but
different things.
Right.
On Curb, it seemed like it went quickly into like more surreal. So in general, I like things like The Original Office and Marin, as opposed to, and I like the first couple of years of Louis.
Mm-hmm.
But like I joke, in the first year his wife was white, the second year she's black, and the third year his wife was a throw pillow. Because he would change things on that show.
Yes.
So the early years were like the Dane Cook thing.
Yep.
Those were more interesting to me than when it's an hour of him at 7 years old or 12 years old. You know what I'm talking about?
I know exactly what you're talking about. I do, yes.
Yeah.
I think, you know what? Let's have him explain himself. Louis, come on out.
What? Louis, I'm sorry.
Why would
I be saying I'm sorry? Because I want to get into the next project.
Don't we all?
Yeah, why? Yeah. Where's my Louis produced show?
Let's get Dave Rath on the phone. And Dave Becky. Get them both on the phone.
Get Dave Rath's hip pocket on the phone.
hey, here's a comedian who did employ you.
Is this your life now?
Let's talk about your work on Everybody Loves Raymond. On your previous appearance on the chat show, I don't think you talked about it much.
I came up with the idea of the show.
Really?
And I said to them, I don't want to be the center of it. That's not what I'm about.
Very giving.
That was an amazing thing to do. Everybody Loves Raymond.
28 episodes playing Andy. And there are air quotes on there.
Two of those appearances are Wedding Part 1 and Part 2, where there's no dialogue.
Does that only count as one appearance or two appearances?
There's two appearances.
That's right.
What are you, doing an after a SAG?
I was just about to say, according to the contract,
that's right.
That's two appearances.
That's right.
That's correct. You got that right.
And now we're moving on to the union round. No, that was an amazing... Well, first of all, I like to pretend that people are asking me. A lot of people ask me, Andy, on Raymond, did you have to study to be a Jew to take the part?
Yeah.
I did not start out with Ray Romano.
No.
We're both from New York City. Don't read your emails.
You're telling the story, and I'm checking the tweets because people have questions.
I know. I don't really require all of this attention. But he started in New York. We're both from Queens.
Yeah.
When I fly to JFK,
yeah.
I'm a hero still. If I stand on a revolving platform in the main terminal with all the seasons of the DVD with me,
yep,
and we slowly revolve, I won't stop getting recognized, Sam. But Ray and this is our interesting facts that after the podcast, people are free to look up
mm-hmm.
and to get a Kevin Bacon 5 degrees. Is that the guy who's
6 degrees? 6 degrees.
Yes.
Yep.
We were both on the HBO Young Comedian special together. That's a little known.
You were.
That's a very known fact. And who else was on there, Sam?
Judd Apatow.
And who else was on there, Sam?
David Spade.
No. Yeah. It was hosted by Dana Carvey, Ray Romano, Bill Bellamy. I'm pausing for applause. Nick DiPaolo, who was hilarious. Mm-hmm. Janine Garofalo.
Also hilarious.
Hello. And I forget, and I'm leaving out a couple of people. It was off the hook. Ray Romano.
Sure.
It was off the hook.
Off the hook.
And it was recorded, and this is a backstage stuff that people really love.
Yeah.
We did two shows.
Whoa.
And
you spliced them together.
And you spliced them together, except my pocket was out. My pocket of my pants had pulled out.
Yeah.
So very quickly, either on the world's greatest magician, and it's the most boring trick ever.
Especially,
ta-da, well, pants, pocket pulled out.
Right.
Ta-da, back in.
Well, you didn't say ta-da. That was the problem.
Which is still the greatest joke,
right? The audience didn't know.
You know that joke, right?
Maybe I don't.
That's the world's greatest. It's one of the world's greatest jokes. I won't tell it well, but the magician gets on stage. He goes, I will perform to you the greatest trick that's ever been performed in the entire world. So anyone in the audience can come up and hit me over the head with a sledgehammer, and I will survive it and be amazed. So the guy comes from the audience, hits the magician over the head with a sledgehammer. His skull cracks open. He's bleeding. He's in a coma for 7 months. He wakes up out of the coma, and he says, ta-da! And that's the story of my life.
On your deathbed,
I do these speeches
ta-da.
In Montreal. I put everybody down.
Yep.
I don't get work.
Mm-mm.
Ta-da!
Speaking of your life,
I like the way you toss the top of the with a devil may care attitude.
I don't need it.
You mean
I'm
business.
Finish this bottle.
You mean you're the edgiest bottled water drinker I've ever seen.
I'm the Andrew Dice Clay of bottled water.
Yeah. Hey,
drinkers.
You know what? Get out of here, Cap.
Get out of here.
Get out of here, device that holds the water in.
There. I don't need it.
Yeah.
I don't need it at all.
Exactly.
1 week from today.
Apple Store. 10 minutes from now.
1 week from today.
1 week from today is a milestone.
Is a milestone for you, is it not?
Yes. And my wife, who is not listening to this, because why belabor it? Laughter. Add that in later.
We'll add it in.
Says, do you have to tell everybody how old you are? Do you have to order? Like, I'm in a restaurant. I'll have the shrimp scampi. I'm going to be 60.
Yes.
And I will be 60.
It's a separate dish, though. It's a separate dish.
it's
scampi, not spicy.
And I had written this, what I thought was hilarious, 55 and over Denny's bit about how they have a senior menu.
Yep.
and everything on the menu says senior, you have to order, I'll have the senior chicken. Mm-hmm. And so one of the items is senior tilapia. I don't even like young bottom feeding fish, but a wrinkled old tilapia? Cancel my order. I'll have the soup. Send me, I'll take the senior gazpacho. Here's me fake laughing.
All right,
so I'll be 60 years old on October 16th.
Maybe it's a Mexican dish. Maybe it's senior tilapia. Have you considered this?
Don't make my jokes funnier.
Don't punch
them up.
That's
the last thing I need.
Don't punch it up.
I'm going to make that.
I'm going
to take that
for notes.
Denny's bit that my wife doesn't want me to do.
Please.
And I'm going to turn it into senior.
Senior.
Senior
tilapia.
Is that, that's not a Mexican. Come on.
What are we doing? What is this?
Woohoo!
The bandoleros?
And the Mexican songs.
In all of them?
I sound like a Trump surrogate. In the Mexican songs.
You know, you ever heard of something saying in Spanish?
And always... some of them, I assume, are not rapists.
Oh, boy.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to bring everybody down.
That's all right.
It's very bad when you're doing a bit where you're putting down Trump, and yet somehow you end up yelling rapists.
That's most bits when you're talking about
That's my whole first album. I'm going to shock you. I got it in your face, Skinla. Hey, how's everybody doing? Rapists. You are, and that, for some reason, using the pen microphone and holding it in a very...
You've gone to Bob Barker style.
Let's just say flamboyant. That's why Jerry got so upset. You're operating your phone like a gay French king, he said. And he didn't, for one second, people weren't doubled over with paramedics needing to revive them from laughter. And Jerry said, that's it. Comedy club crowds are bad. I'm done.
I know he said colleges were bad.
Colleges and comedy club crowds.
And comedy club?
I will be in my tower, literally.
But... Let's...
Hey, come down to Senor Tilapia.
Hey,
Senor Tilapia, what's on the menu? Bottom feeding fish.
Very old. It's very old fish.
Come down to Senor Tilapia. All the tilapia you can stomach. For $9.99. Hey, you can have more. I'm done. No. Is this my Mexican guy?
I guess it is.
Do a Mexican guy and see if this show doesn't get shut down in 5 minutes.
Oh.
If you don't get knocked off of Hulu.
Hey, see.
Hey.
Senor Tilapia, open for business. It's not.
Why can't we do a Mexican voice? Hey. Hey, do you want to know? Do you want to know what kind of fish? Do you want to know the fish today?
Oh, boy. We're going to get letters. Is what's going to happen.
We're not gonna get, you can't get letters when people have turned this off 20 minutes ago. Although, you know what? The kind of people who listen to the show?
Yeah.
Snail mail enthusiasts.
That's right. We still get snail mail to the show often, right?
Do you know what I do, Sam?
What are you doing?
I take the box tops from my cereal. There's not even anything on the back of the box that indicates that I should do this. I cut off... all the stuff from my Barbara's puffins, my puffins.
Puffins.
And I send them in, plus $3.
Mm-hmm.
And I say, what do you want to give me? What do you got? A whistle?
What do they got?
God, you ever wish you didn't start a joke? Not even a joke.
No.
I'm giving myself too much credit.
Yeah.
That's why I never would do improv.
Never. Your whole life is improv.
Yes, and I like
it. Here it is.
Yes, and...
yes, and...
another thing.
Here's a third thing. Here is a thing. Here's a question.
And why am I still yelling when I'm mic'd?
That doesn't matter.
Because I'm in a theater.
People muted this 20 minutes.
Who am I?
Friend of mine, Tammy Lefko, has...
I know Tammy Lefko.
Of course you do. Friend of ours, Tammy
Lefko. I was a friend with Tammy Lefko before... I don't know if I was. Why do I have to establish... I knew her in the 40s. 50s, 70s.
Sure.
Right,
yeah. She wants to know, have you watched any of the new fall shows? And on
yes.
a scale of 1 to 10, how out of control is the exposition on these shows? Example, this is her favorite. This is a quote. I'm not just speaking as your partner, as your brother. This is a bad idea. That's a line from Notorious.
Okay. Now, what is Notorious?
Notorious, I guess, is a show about murder, maybe?
I the only one I've watched, and yeah. I love it already, and yeah. I binge watch it.
Uh-oh.
And when I say I binge watch it, I vomit before I watch it.
Oh, that's
not
purge.
The wrong.
Purge.
I don't. Oh, the show that I like, I don't yeah. binge watch it. I purge watch it.
There it is.
And it's Kevin Can Wait. He's back.
He's finally.
Kevin James is back. And guess what?
What?
He's got a hot wife.
He sure does.
That you wouldn't normally see him with in real life.
Is he married in real life, Kevin James?
I don't know. But he's had two shows in a row.
Yeah.
I'm not like you, tied to looks. I don't know what I'm saying. Kevin Can Wait.
Kevin Can Wait. You're watching that.
I'm watching that, and okay. I can wait.
You can, as it turns out.
Hey, maybe he can wait. I can't wait for the show to get funny. Hey, I tried to watch Kevin Can Wait. I don't have that much time. Is that good? Because I won't listen back. Someone tweet me that.
This was on your audition tape for Kevin Can Wait.
On my, you know what? I send out sizzle reels for auditions now.
Yeah. Did you, this is something that was brief. No, don't.
Oh.
Don't rip it off. That was briefly discussed on your last appearance here, but it's been 6 years. Everyone's forgotten. Then this is true, and this is one of my proudest accomplishments in show business. On the one season only, very sad, television program called Raising Dad, way back in '01, you and I, this the one and only time.
The only time we were together where you were my...
I played your nephew.
Nephew.
On Raising Dad.
And that's something that you think would have become a cottage industry for us.
The most perfect casting.
We had so much fun doing that show.
We really did. But let's just talk about this. So Raising Dad, Bob Saget was on the program.
Right.
Kat Dennings from Two Broke Girls on the program. And then, of course, Academy Award winner Brie Larson.
Oh, I can't. First of all, she was the sweetest kid.
Sweet,
Brie,
12 years
Brie
old
Larson.
When you did the show.
The sweetest kid. And... she's turned out to be an amazing actor and very nice person. And how do I judge it?
How?
Very nice to me.
That's
and
the most important
and
thing.
And the vent. And the vent. She didn't call me grandpa
when
or
did
anything.
You see her?
About 2 or 3 years ago, before she did the movie.
Oh.
The movie with the kid and the
yeah.
thing, which Room. I watched.
Room.
This is why I've never got money as a reviewer. This week, I saw the movie with The Room and The Thing. And I do as a Jackie Mason.
Yeah.
And the woman and the kid does not know that he could not leave the house because of the abuse. Very good. Slow moving. Should have had more sets.
It's a Gene Shalit.
Gene Shalit. Gene Shalit, if you suffer, I was just about to do a dementia joke, but if you did suffer from dementia, I bet the first things that would leave your head would be like, who Adam Levine is.
Doesn't make
Doctor,
sense.
I'm worried. I woke up today
yep.
knowing who Adam Levine was.
Yep.
By the time I went to sleep, I forgot. That's the and the doctor knows. He looks on the list of
yep.
things to
yep.
worry about.
Yep.
No, that's fine. If you
Prince, what's the problem?
If Adam you forgot who Angelina Jolie was.
Yeah.
But this is the type of thing that's normal to forget. Adam Levine.
Yeah.
Who was the other person we're talking about?
Gene Shalit.
Gene Shalit.
Yep.
The guy on the Today Show
yeah.
who used to say, my father, who passed away, God bless him. I don't know why I say God bless him. I enjoy it.
Sure.
He hated the part on the Today Show where you honor someone for how old they were.
They still
he just
do
think,
that.
Yeah, who's
the
that
Smuckers.
Guy?
Well, he's Willard
Scott.
Scott.
Yeah. That's a name you'll forget.
Oh, apparently I didn't.
Did he die?
I think Willard Scott
he's still around.
Is alive, but he's now, he's going to be on one of those Smucker's cans in a minute.
He's going to be, that's going to yeah. be the last show.
Yeah.
I've turned 112 today.
Right.
Good night.
Good night.
Wrap it up.
Yeah.
And that's the rest
of the story.
Paul Harvey reference.
It's true.
It's true. And they don't know it. These kids, you could tell that they're mocking us with that laughter, Sam.
Well, I think they're humoring us more than mocking.
The world's most paranoid comedian. I hear the laughter. You don't think I hear them laughing? Andy, you're a comedian.
Andy, we're looking for laughs.
This is the show. This is going to be my next network show.
Right.
Why are they laughing at me? You're a comedian. Big laugh from the audience. I was watching Kevin James.
Mm-hmm.
This is from my act. And my friend said, we were looking at him on the TV show. And my friend said, has he had some work done? And I said, not on his act. Now, that joke didn't get a big enough laugh because I tipped that it was from, I used the word act.
You said act already.
But this isn't a club.
No, technically it's a club, but there's no one here. So if a club is empty, is it still a club? And the answer is only if I'm playing there.
Also, if you were going to do a documentary about me.
Yep.
What better symbol than an empty club?
An empty club.
Empty club. No laughs.
What is the fewest people in a real audience at a real club you were playing?
I think I played for four people.
Three.
Now, that being said, it was a 5-seater.
Oh.
So it looked good.
So you were playing the back of a Subaru.
I can't hear the canned laughter. I can't hear.
No, we added in post. We're going to fix that later. Not to worry about.
Whoa, all of a sudden, that was the first lull, and we're in. Unbelievable.
It is unbelievable. Well, we are fast approaching.
I have no, this is the worst, this is the most fear, this is the most, like, something that would scare people listening to this.
Yeah.
I have no time constraints.
You do have time constraints, though.
Oh, I want to hear the debate.
Yeah, when I asked you if you could do the show today, you said, I don't know. I have to be home
I have
for the
to
debate.
Watch the debate because I must and online, and you probably saw online
yeah,
today.
Yeah.
I don't know. Do you see my stupid arguments? You're like a rational human being.
I did see.
I bet you don't have more than 4,000 tweets total.
I have slightly over 4.
I have 4 million tweets. That's how bad my
really
tweeting
have 4 million?
Is. No, but I have too many.
Okay. But
that's exaggeration.
Well, you're not afraid of conflict on Twitter.
I get in the fray. I'm not above the fray.
No.
I'm right in the middle of the fray.
Yeah.
And Donald Trump must be defeated. I know you listeners out there in California, you're all Trump, Kevin Pollak chat showers.
I don't, my guess is we don't have a whole lot of Trump supporters, but let me ask you, I want to recommend right now that you start an advice column.
Okay.
And here's your first question, and it comes from me. I recently learned through the magic of Facebook that a former flame of mine, a gal who I was had a romantic relationship with.
Was attracted to me?
Not a long amount of time, but
okay.
Enough amount of time that I still, you know... Like
this isn't going to get my marriage in trouble, is it?
Depends on how you answer. that through the magic of Facebook, I've learned that she is a fanatical Trump supporter.
Oh, you can't talk to her anymore.
I haven't spoken to her in years.
Yeah, just I would not talk to her and hope that she changes.
Right. I don't know how to feel about
this. How did that happen, though? Well, how well? And how long did you go out with her for?
A couple months.
Is she smart?
I thought so.
How could anyone smart vote? You have to be both. If you were smart, you'd have to be so angry or prejudiced or racist. Is she racist?
It's she herself. Is a minority.
Oh my God.
Which is the most.
She's a self-hating person.
It's the most baffling part of
that
it.
That happens a lot, though.
It would be like if you and I went out stumping for David Duke.
Is he on the wrong side?
What if I said Farrakhan? That's more obvious, right?
Well, Louis Farrakhan, I'm not a fan. I think David, for some reason, I see David Duke as worse than Louis Farrakhan.
Yeah.
But. Do I have to have that discussion?
No, we don't have to have that discussion.
Today on the show, justify why Louis Farrakhan is slightly better.
Oh, that's a terrible...
But also, everything depends on the time period that you're in. You know, like Muhammad Ali, he started out as a following Elijah Muhammad. Mm-hmm. Then he trans. You know, that was part of the time period he was in.
Right.
So, like, I started out... In the Jewish Defense League. Nobody knows the JDL.
Everybody here knows the JDL. No? They're thinking of Julia Louis-Dreyfus. That's a different thing altogether.
Yeah, the radical Jewish people.
Right.
Like Meir Kahane.
Ooh. Are you going to do the biopic? I really,
well, he got assassinated.
I'm fairly certain he did.
And I had a joke about it in my act because he said that one Jewish life was worth 1 million Arab lives. This is one of his quotes.
Yeah.
So my joke was, who would want to hurt that guy?
Mm-mm.
This joke was big. You guys don't laugh now. When I open with my gold in my ear, gold to your ear.
Gold in my ears, this act.
I did my Bella Abzug chomp. I ended up with my Shirley Chisholm impression. So that's my only time constraint, is I must go back.
You must go back to catch
and Trump must lose.
To catch the debate.
We're sunk. This country is sunk. If Trump wins. If he wins.
Yeah, but that's not gonna happen.
It's not gonna happen. I agree with you, but what something could have, a mistake could be made somehow. People could hit the wrong lever.
You think we're gonna have more hanging chads?
I worry about the Russians in general or someone rigging the election.
It's tough to rig though. Still,
well, here's
the
thing.
Country does the hand ballots, you know.
Right. Now here's where you know that the GOP has been racist. And I know a lot of people say, Andy, please end your appearance with a strident rant.
Some heated political talk.
Yeah.
That's what I was hoping for.
I hate the GOP, and I'm not saying there aren't traditionally great people in it like Lincoln.
Yeah.
But I hate them because in my lifetime, they've just been about wedge issues and racism. And the most racist one is this voter suppression thing. They always lie.
Whoa. Oh, we're worried about voter fraud. Now, let me ask you all a question out there, whoever's listening. How do you win an election by sending imposters to the poll? Well, how does it work? The guy who's really Eddie Schmidoopy, you put something in his tea?
Yeah.
He falls out and you go to the poll as him?
Yeah.
How? Then you can't win an election by sending imposters to the poll.
No, of course not.
So it's a totally phony thing. It's not even a real issue.
No, it's not. And every now and then they will have some low-level GOP guy giving an interview where they ask about voter fraud and is this really an issue, and they will accidentally say something like, well, look, at the end of the day, you know, these are in place because there are certain people who, you know, we don't want to vote.
Right.
They'll accidentally literally say the thing that they're secretly trying to do, but it's not a secret anymore.
Yeah,
but
if you want to steal an election, you stuff ballot boxes,
right,
or you do something up the line,
right,
from
I'll say this
precinct by precinct.
I'll say this about all of this. November 8th cannot get here fast enough.
I know. You know,
I am at my wit's end with everything.
Are you? But you don't seem upset about it. I'm actually like on a day-to-day level, I can't sleep.
I know you are. I read your Twitters.
Yeah, that's what I like. Even this morning, when people are arguing about. My personal opinion is, and I'm completely honest about it. The reason why I didn't like Bernie, what he did, his campaign, I don't buy the idea that because you take contributions, that means you're corrupt.
Yeah.
I don't think Barack Obama is corrupt.
Yeah.
And I think fundamentally to argue that Hillary Clinton votes on the basis of that she gave a speech at Goldman Sachs, you could say whatever you want. She shouldn't have done it or whatever. It was legal for her to do it. I couldn't care less that Leno's getting $500,000. I couldn't care less how much he's making. And I couldn't care less about the transcripts. And I think it's a phony issue.
Yeah.
Because if you show me where she voted on a quid pro quo basis, don't tell me she took a meeting with someone because they were in the Clinton Foundation. Tell me what she did as a person.
Right.
And that's what I object to, this whole idea of, if Obama hadn't taken super PAC money, he wouldn't have won either election. Right?
I guess that's probably
and
true.
And even though he wants the election laws changed, and this is the way you argue effectively.
Right, although admittedly, Citizens United, when you say he took super PAC money, by virtue of he had nothing to do with it.
Right,
theoretically, the candidates are removed from.
And of course, they yell at Hillary Clinton about, like, she's, you know, super PACs. The Citizens United was based on a movie, some horrible movie made about the Clintons. That's what it was based on.
I didn't know
that. Judicial Watch. Someone knows what I'm talking about.
That's
they made it into a test case.
Yeah.
And the idea was that could you show this campaign movie about her. And I don't know the details because I don't know the details of anything I argue.
That's the most important thing is to not have details. Here's a question that has nothing to do with any of that. Will we ever in our lifetimes have another David Letterman?
I think that's a great question. I hate when people say it's a great question, but that's a great question. No, there'll never be another David Letterman.
Right?
No.
He was the last of a generation.
I don't know if he was the last. I think the next thing that will come along that will be like David Letterman won't be. Right. I don't know. I can't even say any statement I would make. I can't say it's no one's going to host a show.
My question is, what do people watch now late night? Because
I do watch things. Watch people. I love any kind of karaoke, carpool or otherwise. but
that's
no
the
one
thing.
Will be
Everything
like his.
Is turned into like I think it was Billy Eichner that said it best. It's like a children's birthday party that we're watching now, especially on Jimmy Fallon. It's like we have to play all these games, or we have to do carpool karaoke, or what? No, why? Like, I don't understand why we have to have Diane Keaton come on and have a pasta eating contest.
Right.
It's like, what is going on?
But I'll watch, like I think Seth Meyers does great interviews.
I agree. I'm really enjoying what he's been doing.
I still watch Conan. I watch
Conan. Yeah, Conan is, like, I would say the...
Yeah, but Letterman to me is my hero. So,
oh, sure.
But it's like, I don't know. There's always going to be people of every generation who... are that great, mm-hmm. but it's not going to be the same way ever again like it was with Letterman or Carson before him.
Yeah. So you know? I guess what you're saying is no.
And I love Carson.
Oh, sure.
But for me, Letterman was more my generation, but that doesn't mean I don't appreciate Carson.
As an almost 60-year-old man. Folks, Andy Kindler turned 60 one week from today, so if you're not following him on Twitter, and you're not going to wish him a happy 60th birthday... You're worse than Donald Trump and Hitler combined.
I have one more week to turn it all around.
There's so much you wanted to do before 60.
I can't say, so many projects are like late 50s that I'm still going out
You're still going out for.
Yeah, I'm not ready for the guy who's the head of the condo association in Fort Lauderdale.
Can I tell you this? You are one of the youngest looking 60s.
I used to win bar contests all the time.
Yeah, bar bets?
Yeah, because people always thought I was 25 until I was like 45.
Really?
But then when they started in the last 5 or 6 years to get closer to my actual age,
it's
not fun anymore.
You stopped taking the bets.
How old do you think I am? 58? No, I'm going to be 60. What's the upside to that? I don't know, 54?
Free drink?
Well, if they said 43, if someone said, get out of here.
Let's not be ridiculous. all right, so we've talked for quite a while, and I thank you for your time, and I do want to get you out of here, because I know it's not just about watching these debates. You got to get home, you got to sit down, you got to get your favorite blanket out, you got to have all your snacks,
popcorn.
And your dips, and your chips.
Dips.
And your popcorns, and your wings. I know you're a big wing guy.
My Anderson Cooper t-shirt.
Yep. I did threaten you and remind you, you're not allowed to leave here without doing the Larry King game.
I don't even think you're going to get rid of me after the show.
That's fantastic.
I'm going to ask you what you're doing. You're already giving me a lift home.
I do. I was just about to say, you and I live in the same part of town, and I foolishly, perhaps.
Well, you can at least legally take the carpool lane.
It's true. I already told Andy I'm going to have to put my carpool lane dummy in the trunk so that he can sit in the passenger.
Well, first he said he's not moving the dummy.
I did say that. I said I was going to move the dummy to the trunk and you're going to have to watch
attached.
Me move it. I am attached to that dummy. That dummy is one of my oldest friends. I've had that dummy for 13 years.
I love that story about
his bar mitzvah.
The cop.
With the hand. Yeah, picked up his hard plastic hand and waved it at the cop. So are you ready to do your Larry King game? When you were ready, you're going to look down the barrel of that camera right there.
I can see that camera.
It's right there. You can't miss it.
Do you know I'm looking past that the whole time? And that's actually the best thing to do. I was looking back there the whole time like an idiot.
All right.
So give me an example of how it would go.
So you do a bad Larry King impression, not a good one. And it's just the quick aside, something personal about Larry, a little TMI moment about Larry.
Yeah.
And then you throw to the phones, and if the name of the
city... Do I do it as Larry?
Yes.
Okay.
And then the name of the city you throw to, if it happens to be funny, it's not going to hurt. But that's it. Those are the parameters, and when you're ready, go for it.
For the entire hour tonight, Vladimir Putin. For the entire hour, Vladimir Putin, you're a dictator. Vladimir, you're a vicious, murderous dictator. How do you take your coffee? Vladimir Putin for the entire hour. You like horses. My guest for the entire hour. Murderous dictator, Russian dictator who's poisoned people. Just for an Ashton Kutcher-style laugh. For the entire hour. What's your question for Milwaukee, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, hello?
That's a good
What's your question for Vladimir Putin?
The Larry King game. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That was tremendous.
I think it was one of my best work.
I think this episode has been live streaming to the head of CBS, Les Moonves. We've been in his limo the whole time.
Look at me. This is why I don't get acting work. That's my surprise guy. Oh. No, no, not Muppet surprised. Oh.
He's on the limo. The limo just turned around violently in traffic, and he's going to come back here, and then Cassandra.
Bang it on.
Cassandra and Crucial Taunt, we're all going to get
Yahoo it.
Deals. Ladies and gentlemen, that is Andy Kindler for you. I cannot thank you enough from the bottom of my heart for...
This was wonderful.
This was wonderful, and I want to do this with you every Sunday. Cameras be damned.
Let's make it a religious event.
I'm going to cancel on this show to invite you to the brunches that I have.
Oh my God, I can't. This is just the start.
This is it.
Deli,
we're gonna do arts.
Complaining.
You wanna do arts?
Sure.
Okay. So come by to Arts
Every
Deli.
Every sandwich is a situation.
All right, now sit there for 1 second while I wrap things up and I get these people out of here. Well, ladies and gentlemen, when you call for an Andy Kindler, you're never gonna be disappointed. And I am certainly not. I cannot thank my guest Andy Kindler enough. What a treat that was for me. Jamal, thank you, as always, for coming in, sending us some good T5s and other things. Do we have anything to add before we get out of here? Did I miss anything?
No, I mean, I believe that this was our most Jewy show ever.
That was what I threatened people with
at the
top. But it
was excellent. So
there was a disclaimer.
Yes.
So you can't sue us. You can try.
Do an ad for Rhombus Space. I endorse Rhombus Space.
Not Squarespace.
Rhombus Space.
Rhombus Space.
When you want your website to look not so square.
Not so typical. A little.
Who likes rhombus? I'll probably write that on the card.
You should definitely
write
that on the card.
Right under Senor Tilapia.
There's a couple people to thank before we can get out of here. Of course, helping out on Team Chat Show, Dr. Kenny Chen, Mike Duman, Jason McIntyre. We had Megan Williams on Make It Today. Thank you for making Andy and I look human. The gang here at the West Side Comedy Theater. If you are in the Los Angeles area, come check out some shows here. Of course, Jamie Foxx, thank you for helping out, as always, and adding your wit and wisdom to the show.
Yeah,
and Chat Show himself, Kevin Elliott Pollack, who is not here. He's in mid-flight, or hopefully at LAX by now, because...
He has a thriving career. He's got things going on.
He's got too much going on. He can't be here with us. But we love
Avalon. He's doing Avalon 2.
next week... Oh, this is going to upset me. I just remembered this. Next week, I will not be here. I will be in Austin, Texas. But Kevin is going to be here interviewing one of my favorites, Mr. Pete Holmes. So definitely come back and check that one out. And I guess the last thing that I can tell you is if you haven't checked out Crunch Time on roosterteeth.com, for fuck's sake, what are you waiting for? It's fucking good. So
why are you so angry?
I'm very upset
about
this.
It's on roosterteeffeathers.com?
No, that's a different thing. Don't confuse people.
What is this
comedy
called?
Rooster Teeth.
Oh, Rooster Teeth. That's different then.
That's a different thing. This is not the comedy club.
It's for rooster-oriented shows?
It's for roosters who
and
have
teeth?
Access to the internet.
And dental shows.
It's for roosters with dental work that needs to be done.
I love dental shows.
I know you do. So check out the dental theme show Andy and I are going to be bringing on the road to Rooster Teeth Feathers.
My new show, Twilight Sleep, is on.
Twilight Sleep. We're going to workshop all of these ideas and more. But until next time, and as always, fuck off.